Hello, welcome to the News Digest this week with me, Vivian Kamsimi. The Netherlands Institute for Multi-Party Democracy has withdrawn funding from the Inter-Party Organization for Dialogue because of opposition boycotts. The Institute has been funding iPod activities to the tune of 1.5 billion annually, billion shillings here. And we are here with the country director to find out what is at loss. Welcome to the News Digest.
Thank you so much. Thank you for having me. I am Frank Rusa, and I am the country director for the Netherlands Institute for Multi-Party Democracy.
Paint us a picture of what is at loss without this funding.
Yes, let me just say that for the last 13 years, we have been the hosts of the iPod Secretariat. What this means is that we provide a safe space for political parties with the representation in parliament to continue having conversations among themselves, to resolve conflicts as may arise, and also to work together to deepen the multi-party political system in Uganda. Unfortunately, last year, the National Unity Platform indicated that it will not be joining the new iPod Memorandum of Understanding, and we're also seeing some reluctance from the Forum for Democratic Change. The other five political parties in parliament have all signed up and they are willing to continue this dialogue. But because we are so strong on inclusion, this kind of situation has forced us to reassess our relationship with iPod, and as NIMD we will not be hosting the iPod Secretariat anymore until it becomes more inclusive, hopefully. But we shall continue engaging with them to try and join.
With those iPod brawls, would you say your methods are registering success in Uganda?
By the time we went to the multi-party political system in 2005, Uganda had been for close to 20 years in a no-party, also known as movement political system. So we really did not understand how political parties work. How do political parties relate with each other outside the competition we see in election times? We did not know that it is possible to cooperate even while you compete. Because you see, all political parties are ruling parties in waiting. Some people in opposition can one day come into power. Some people in power can actually go into opposition one day. And they are all working to improve the country. It is just alternative visions to take the country forward.
You are accused by some opposition parties of serving the interests of governments. Is there some truth of that?
No. Our organization, as I have said, has the principle of neutrality and impartiality. Now, I understand that some people in the opposition feel that if you allow smaller opposition parties to interact with the ruling party, there are chances that the ruling party will dominate the meeting or will project power and thereby look like it is the biggest beneficiary of it. There's that kind of perception, but that's not true, because what matters is how structured is the conversation. Is it structured? Does every party have an equal opportunity to make an input? Does every vote around the table matter? And in iPod, it's not even really about votes. It's about consensus.
How far are you with negotiations to convince FDC to sign the Memorandum of Understanding and join iPod this year?
Yes, we have tried to speak to the leaders of... We thought that it would be important to create spaces, safe spaces outside the public glare for the leadership of some of these parties to talk to each other on these key issues, even before we sign the Memorandum of Understanding, even before we go to the big summits and the big meetings. Maybe there is need to develop trust, inter-party trust, between one party with another. And we have made some attempts to speak to some of these people, but I get the sense that some of the opposition kingpins in this country think that if word leaks that they are having some conversations with the ruling party, they will lose politically. They will look weak. They will look, maybe their base will be disappointed in them. But for me, I think that's not right, because the base, all the citizens of Uganda, want solutions. And these solutions can be arrived at by consensus. You are only 50-something in parliament. The ruling party has over 300 members. You can never get anything you want passed if the other side doesn't agree with you. So because they have the numbers, so it becomes almost necessary to be willing to build bridges between political parties. And we shall keep trying. We shall keep trying to get them to see this.
So how prepared are you to build some trust with the opposition?
One thing I need to emphasize is that for NUP to get government to respond positively to them, they need to recognize that NRM is the legitimate ruling party of Uganda because it was elected. But also the NRM needs to understand that the NUP is the legitimate leader of opposition because it was elected. Now, for these two groups to look at each other as legitimate political actors requires them to respect each other.
What is the future of dialogue between parties in Uganda?
I think that at the moment, the hardline position is being taken on by the leadership of the NUP is making it almost very difficult to imagine a progressive dialogue happening. But I believe also that we need to invite to widen the conversation and maybe say that dialogue should not only be between political parties. Maybe the time has come for our country to review or ask themselves the question of, do we need a national dialogue? A dialogue that can involve maybe the religious leaders, that can bring civil society on board, that can bring political parties, those in parliament and even those that are outside parliament but that are playing a big leadership role in the country, to get into the conversation. I feel that kind of dialogue may be what this country needs.
Frank Rusa, thank you for speaking to the News Digest. Until next week, every Thursday, the News Digest in the news.